this video, we will be discussing the life and career of one Steve Winwood, the young musical prodigy that rose to the top of the pop charts in the 1960s with the Spencer Davis Group, and later on formed the improvisationally driven band Traffic. His star rose to new heights in the 1980s, propelled by a string of massive radio hits. He is widely revered for his incredible, unique, and award-winning voice. Personally, the more I think about Steve Winwood and his music, the more I can't get it out of my head. Stephen Lawrence Winwood was born May 12, 1948, in Handsworth, Birmingham, England. Born to a working-class family, his father, who worked in a local foundry, played saxophone and clarinet in various local Dixieland and jazz groups as a semi-professional musician. At an early age, Winwood began playing the piano and was also a choir boy at the local church, St. John's Church of England. Winwood describes how he would sometimes sneak into the sanctuary when the coast was clear and noodle around on the house pipe organ. This began his fascination and love of the instrument. Winwood describes how, even at a very young age, his musical trajectory took a sharp turn when he heard Ray Charles for the first time. After hearing his voice, Stephen set out to emulate his style. And just a few years later, his ability to do so would make him very popular in the local Birmingham scene. Stephen eventually attended the Birmingham Midland Institute of Music to study piano, and during his time, he even met future Fleetwood Mac member Christy McVie. Stephen started playing with a local group, the Ron Atkinson Band, as a guitar player and organist. The group would back many legendary blues bands from the United States, like Muddy Waters, John Lee Hooker, Howlin' Wolf, B.B. King, Chuck Berry, and Bo Diddley, who oftentimes would play with local groups when they toured overseas. And at age 14, Stephen was asked to join the Spencer Davis Group, which featured his older brother on bass. Spencer Davis was the frontman of the group, and Stephen initially played lead guitar. But as time progressed and Winwood's abilities as a vocalist became more apparent, he started to take on the duties of lead singer more and more. And like many Birmingham groups at the time, the Spencer Davis Group started out as a straightforward blues band. But as the popularity of their scene grew, and as more and more teenagers and young women began attending their shows, it became apparent that they needed to produce more pop material. One of their early songs, Keep On Running, written by Jamaican artist Jackie Edwards, featured Winwood on lead vocals and was one of the group's early forays into this territory. The song knocked the Beatles' Day Tripper off the top slot on the UK pop charts in January 1966. The success of the single brought some money to the group, and Winwood was able to afford to buy his own Hammond organ, which would be featured on many of the group's songs moving forward and would become part of the group's signature sound. As rumors of the power and soulfulness of this young 16-year-old's voice made waves in England, he was admired by many of his white British peers for his ability to emulate an African-American style of singing, which was very sought after in England's blues scene. Steve Winwood could be considered one of the early examples of what is generally referred to as blue-eyed soul. The term is thought to have been coined by a Philadelphia radio DJ, Georgie Woods, in 1964, initially to describe the band The Righteous Brothers, a group fronted by two white men. But well before the 1960s and before Steve Winwood began performing, there has been much controversy over the decades about this genre of music, if it can be called that. To many, the apparent borrowing of a traditionally black style of singing by a white artist is a form of cultural appropriation. And some people have even described it as a modern-day form of, quote, blackface. However, still others, and perhaps the broader criticism levied by many, is that the music industry has tended to privilege white people over African Americans. This is a systemic racism argument and points to a cultural and economic injustice, as opposed to arguing that it is simply a form of artistic theft or cultural appropriation. On the other hand, there is the argument that good music is just good music, and no matter where it comes from, or who can culturally lay claim to it, or who is performing it, that if it sounds good, it just sounds good. The fact of the matter is that Steve Winwood has an amazing voice. To my ears, it definitely sounds like he is influenced by this black idiom. But the interesting part about Steve Winwood is his ability to make this style his own. At no point on listening to a Steve Winwood vocal do I think, oh, he's forcing it, or he is trying too hard to sound a way that his voice doesn't sound. That's just the way his voice sounds. With Steve Winwood, it sounds very natural to me. But again, we could go on and on about this genre of blue-eyed soul, but I figured I would mention it because it is a term that is often attributed to his music. Steve Winwood also started to develop as a songwriter, and he co-wrote the band's breakthrough hits Gimme Some Lovin' and I'm a Man, which both broke the top 10 in the US and the UK in 66 and 67 respectively. And in 1966, the band starred in a very silly Beatles-esque British comedy called The Ghost Goes Gear. And according to Winwood, when he looks back on the decision to appear in the film, he views it as a mistake and an attempt at naked commercialism over artistic integrity. And it's believed by many in the group and around the group that this led to Winwood's exit a year later and eventually the dissolution of the entire band in 1969. So in 1967, he leaves the Spencer Davis Group and forms Traffic with Jim Capaldi on drums, Dave Mason on guitar, and multi-instrumentalist Chris Wood, who played flute and saxophone and a variety of other things. And this is a band that Winwood formed, not due to all of the members' musical abilities, but the fact that they were all friends, and he believed that it would be a very organic project. In fact, a lot of the early material for the band, and even the later material for this band, came out of improvisation and jam sessions that the group members had together. And it was very important to Winwood that this band be centered around this concept of the feel of the music as opposed to the sheer technicality of the players. They took this concept of their laid-back, improvisational, easy feel style and actually translated that into real life, because the group purchased a cottage in the country in Northern England where the band all lived together. And it's exactly like what you'd expect a band in 1967 to be doing out on a country estate. Jam sessions and songwriting were punctuated by long episodes of hanging out, smoking weed, taking drugs, and just listening to an eclectic variety of music. This philosophy of collaborative composition started to form, and the band basically wrote all of their songs through jamming together. They would kind of get together in a room, start playing, get a groove, and Steve would just sing some lyrics over the top of the jam that they were playing, and that was how they wrote their songs. This eventually led to a clash within the band because guitarist Dave Mason, while still being a child of the 60s and wanting to do all this cool stuff and hang out in the cottage and out in the woods and jam, he still had this opinion that, hey, we should at least write songs and we should come up with some ideas, some catchy songs that they can play on the radio, and that will you know, propel the career of the band. And they actually did a bunch of Dave Mason's songs, and basically all of Dave Mason's tunes became the group's early hits, because they were written with a hook and people could play them on the radio. The song Feeling All Right was one of these Dave Mason compositions, which has gone on to be covered by countless numbers of bands in the future. In fact, it's even one of those songs that I feel, because it's so simple and because it's kind of groovy, it's like one of those songs that is almost a cliche for a group of musicians to play together when they've never played together. Like, okay, well, what could we play together? Oh, well, Feeling All Right. It's got like two chords to it and we all know it. So these Dave Mason songs were the only songs that were becoming hits on the radio, and that, as you can imagine, led to jealousy from the other members of the band. And not to mention the fact that this concept of writing a song, presenting it to the band, practicing it, and recording it was not the way that Steve Winwood and the rest of the members of Traffic, they didn't want that to be their creative process moving forward. They preferred this idea of jamming and smoking weed and taking drugs and walking around and then jamming again and letting all of this kind of all simmer together, and this organic brilliance will come out of this, you know, this stew and the vibe of them all being together. It's a very annoying, you know, 60s premise. And I've also been with a lot of bands that's what they want to do. It's, I don't know, to me it's kind of annoying. It's sort of boring, because you're like, okay, when are we just going to play a song, guys? When are we just going to stop playing these same four chords for hours and hours? You know, they're groovy bros from England. So this clash between Dave Mason and the rest of the group, it just comes to a head and they have to part ways. So they kick Dave Mason out, you know, which I think he was maybe a little salty about. But around this time, Winwood, when he's not up at the cottage out in the country, he's hanging out with some cool scenesters like Eric Clapton or, you know, Ginger Baker or Jimmy Page and all these other musicians and artists that are all a part of this burgeoning scene in London at the time. And people are hanging out, they're going to parties, the musicians are jamming together, they're trading ideas and styles and slang. And Steve Winwood is still a part of this scene because he was, before Traffic, he was very famous with the Spencer Davis group and not like the other members of Traffic. So he's kind of going off, he's breaking off from the farm cottage crew and hanging out with all these cool scenesters down in London. And then eventually he gets asked by Eric Clapton to form a new group. And Cream had just disbanded. He wanted to move away from what Cream was about in his mind, which I think was like virtuosos, like kind of playing at each other. He wanted to develop this more organic style. So, you know, who better to ask than Steve Winwood, like nice guy Steve Winwood, that's already kind of doing this thing with his own band, with Traffic. So Clapton and him decide they're gonna start this group, but right when they start forming it, Ginger Baker ended up being in the band, which Clapton sees as being a mistake. Ginger Baker, by the way, is the drummer from Cream. I'm not a Ginger Baker fan whatsoever. I know I'm probably going to get some hate comments for that. I just do not like his style of playing. Much more of a Mitch Mitchell fan, if you must know. I like the jazzy. I like his jazzy feel better. Even though Ginger Baker likes to go on and on about how he's not even a rock drummer, that he's really just a jazz drummer, I think Mitch Mitchell destroys him in that department as far as feel is concerned. But I digress. So Winwood, Clapton, Baker, and Rick Grech, who is playing bass, form a supergroup called Blind Faith. And that was actually, Blind Faith was the first time that the UK press had ever used this phrase before. And I think the concept of it is that you've got all these guys from different cool bands coming together in this kind of Voltron of rock awesomeness. And there was a lot of hype about the band before they ever played the first show. But apparently the vibes were not there, because the band really only lasted for about a year. Clapton later on says that he felt that him and Steve Winwood were never really given the opportunity to develop what the band's sound would be. You know, a lot of the Blind Faith songs were written by Winwood, and there's just some amazing tracks there, but it was just too much pressure. I think their first gig that they ever played, they played in this park. Now I can't remember what the park is called, but there was like 20,000 people there at the first gig for the band. That's a lot of pressure for a band to be under when you're, if you're trying to develop a sound and immediately you're like one of the most popular bands in the country, it's a little distracting. You know, with all that pressure combined, the band does not last. And Winwood heads back to the country to play with his old buddies in Traffic again. And I think this whole Blind Faith failed experiment that Winwood has with Clapton is part of this dichotomy that exists in Steve Winwood. This is just my own conjecture, but I feel that he has this inclination within himself to be a sort of solitary figure, to be a chill person. But because he's a young, extremely talented person, and up until this point, ever since he's been 14, 15, he's been playing in these bands and he's received all this early notoriety for his talents. It might even be like how a child star is in Hollywood, where before you even get a chance to ask yourself what you want out of life, you're sort of thrust into this spotlight and it has an effect on you. And just my feeling from hearing interviews with Steve Winwood and others around him, and by observing the facts of his life, he definitely has this dichotomy, and maybe this whole idea of this project of Blind Faith is almost like that other side of him, the side that wants the spotlight, the side that wants to be in the scene, even though Steve Winwood has a kind of an aversion to that life, that hustle and bustle of the social scene, the drugs, the fast living, the publicity that comes along with being a pop star. And I think that Winwood is kind of always teetering on that fulcrum for a good part of his life. On one side is fame and notoriety in the scene, and on the other side is a solitary, rural, peaceful existence. Immediately after the whole Blind Faith project falls apart, he must have in his own mind been like, okay, I'm not gonna really do that again. He kind of goes back to the Traffic way of doing things in this kind of like rural existence for the rest of the 70s and kind of for the rest of his life. When he comes back to Traffic, it's the 70s now, and there's like this new emphasis now on making whole albums as opposed to singles. The early DJs on these FM radio stations were playing like whole sides of records as opposed to like tracks. It's sort of like the underground days, maybe like the early days of the internet. DJs were kind of doing whatever they wanted and, you know, being like, hey man, just listen to it, man. And it was like, that was perfect for Traffic, because Traffic, that's what they do. They jam and they come up with their material from the jamming. And like some of Traffic's most famous tracks are literally just fucking jams, you know? You know, songs that take up an entire side of a record kind of thing. So you got this long format thing that's happening on the radio, and more people are buying LPs, long play records, and listening to them from cover to cover. And then there's another aspect to the culture that's going on at this time, and it's kind of this return to nature, the communalism that we kind of mentioned that they were already doing. But tons of other bands were kind of doing this back to the country pastoral vibe, which fit very well with Traffic as well, because they were really into these old English folk songs and kind of weaving all this mythology. Like the album John Barleycorn in particular is literally about these old agrarian pastoral myths. Traffic is really suited well to this era. Everyone was kind of trying to, like, you know, touch grass. So you got John Barleycorn Must Die in 1970. 1971, you've got the Low Spark of High Heeled Boys. 1973, you've got Shootout at the Fantasy Factory. And then 1974, When the Eagle Flies. And these four albums kind of fit together thematically, because during this period, the songs are very almost unintentional. It's like they spring up out of the earth, out of the countryside where these guys live. But they become, during this period, they become very famous, especially in the United States. So all of this success that they're experiencing culminates in 1974 US tour, which was a lot of dates for the band, during which Winwood falls ill. He's not feeling well. He's meeting with doctors. They can't diagnose what's wrong with him. He eventually flies back to England, where shortly afterwards his appendix explodes and he has to go into the hospital for surgery, which, you know, even though it's the modern era, it's still the 70s, you know, going in for surgery, there's not a zero risk. And all this time that Winwood spends in the hospital before and after surgery gets him thinking about his life, and he decides, I don't want to do this anymore, or I want to rethink this. So at that point, he breaks up the band again. So Traffic is done, and he moves into his own house out in Gloucester, where he actually still lives to this day. And in that mid-70s period, he's rethinking his life. He's trying to find meaning. He's got some sheep. He's got some barley crops and some wheat crops. And he's walking around the countryside, and he's rethinking what gives his life meaning. Finally, he gives a glimpse of what that answer is in 1978. And he releases a self-titled solo album. It's a great album, I think. It's got some kind of Traffic-esque vibes to it. Like, a lot of the songs feel like Traffic songs. They kind of have those breakdowns. They're maybe not as jammy and meandering as Traffic is, but it's got like more, there's more of like a, almost a jazz fusion vibe in some of the tunes, and as was the style of the time. And like I said, I think it's worth checking out. Steve Winwood, 1978. And speaking of things you should check out, it's time to say hello to the sponsor for this video, Rubbish Shirts. Are you a fan of pop culture? Do you often make references to music and movies that no one else remembers or has even heard of before? Are you or someone you love a sucker for ironic and/or humorous clothing? Then you need to visit Rubbish Shirts. You can find their store on both Etsy and eBay. Rubbish Shirts has over 200 designs that reference movies, music, books, slang, or just weird stuff. That's why their motto is Weird Shirts for Cool Jerks. They've got designs featuring your favorite music artists like Steve Winwood, Jeff Lynne, Graham Parsons, Guided by Voices, Weezer, Biggie, Tribe Called Quest, and more. Be the life of your next party or just give them as a gift to your family or significant other. Start a conversation with a complete stranger about Van Halen or have a chuckle with your bestie about your shared appreciation for Funyuns. Every rubbish shirt is factory printed on quality Fruit of the Loom HD cotton shirts. The colors don't fade, and the pre-shrunk heavy cotton shirts stand up to many, many wash and dry loads. How do I know so much about rubbish shirts? Well, as a matter of fact, I make them. Head over to Etsy or eBay and search for rubbish shirts, or click the link below in the video's notes. Rubbish shirts. They're weird shirts for cool jerks. It's now the late 70s. Steve Winwood has just put out his first solo record, which we were just talking about before the break. And to give you a little bit of context for this time period that we're in, you got to be thinking about what's going on in England at this time. And that's like punk rock. It's like 1978. Sex Pistols are out. The Clash is out. You know, everyone loves the Ramones in England. Not in the United States for some reason yet. But anyway, punk rock is going like crazy. Not so much in the United States. In the United States, people are still like trying to chill on the soft rock and like James Taylor and like disco. And like England is kind of going the opposite direction. So I think Winwood pops his head up, releases this album. It's kind of like, it kind of doesn't know what it wants to be yet. He's not really like one of these jazz fusion guys. So he really doesn't want to do that. So he goes back to the drawing board. He goes back to his farm. Around this time, he meets a lyricist named Will Jennings. And Will Jennings is a Grammy Award-winning, Academy Award-winning lyricist. He's written songs like Tears in Heaven, the Eric Clapton hit, and My Heart Will Go On from the Titanic soundtrack. So he's done some like pretty massive hits. He teams up with Steve at this point, and they start collaborating on the songs together. And their first grouping of songs that they wrote, the first evidence of their full-on 100% songwriting collaboration is 1980's Ark of a Diver. And now we're starting to hear something different going on in Steve Winwood's music. The first thing you'll notice about Ark of a Diver is that there are synthesizers. So there's a lot of synths, there's drum machines. It's still a little exploratory, like as far as the song format is concerned, but because he's teaming with this lyricist Will Jennings, I think the lyricism just really does kick up a notch. Because I have no evidence to prove this, but I feel like a guy like Steve Winwood has never been super into lyrics. Because if you know, there's kind of two kinds of guys. It's like people that like to write songs and people that like to jam. And the people that like to jam do not give a crap about the lyrics in their songs. They just want to sing some stuff so they can get back to jamming, because that's what they really want to do. And Steve Winwood, he likes to jam. The man wants to jam. But he meets this guy, Will Jennings, who is just like a world class. I mean, not necessarily at this point, according to the world, but he will eventually become this world renowned lyricist. And Will Jennings adds this component to Winwood's songs that just like, it brings them to life, I think. He's maybe a little hokey. He's maybe a little cheesy sometimes, but he takes this quality of Steve Winwood's music that always had this soulful, kind of gospel, uplifting, and Will Jennings just like perfectly expresses this through the lyrics. The track on Ark of a Diver that just really, really stands out is the first track, While You See a Chance. And when I hear the song While You See a Chance, like there's something that like happens inside of me, and I don't know what it is. It's just like, it's almost magic. It's just like pure bittersweet, but it's very hopeful, and it's just very uplifting to me, very soothing. But I know that a lot of people are going to hear this kind of song and be like, this is cheesy, this is hokey. And I agree, it is. It is cheesy and it's hokey, and it's like It's like a life coach set to music, but it affects me. You put these two guys, Jennings and Winwood, together, they really start to just, there is a synergy between the two of them. So Ark of the Diver, 1980. Then we've got Talking Back to the Night in 1982, which is another album 100% co-written by the two of these guys, Winwood and Jennings. And that features the hit that probably Steve Winwood is most famous for. And it is also track one. It's called Valerie. I know you've heard Valerie. That vocal hook has been like ripped in so many other songs. Steve Winwood is recording and performing 100% of these albums by himself in his house. So there is not, he's not in a professional recording studio. There's not a bunch of studio musicians around him. They might be adding a thing or two during the mixing process. I can't remember like exactly off the top of my head if there's like little bits added here and there, but like pretty much 100% of these two albums are Steve Winwood himself. This is very personal music, and it's written in his little cottage in England and out in the country. Kind of amazing. I don't know. And I mentioned this in my previous video about Jeff Lynne. Check it out. Subscribe if you want to be informed about the next video that comes up. But like I said, just like Jeff Lynne, all of these baby boomer era artists are crossing the threshold into the 80s, and then they're using all the new toys, and it's like affecting the way that they approach their own music, because you had a drum machine and a sequencer and all these other things, and it's all synced together through MIDI and clocks and all this stuff. You can do a lot of things just with one person. But if you listen to Steve Winwood, you might be like, oh yeah, this sounds like Talk Talk. This sounds like Peter Gabriel. This sounds like Don Henley. This sounds like Glenn Frey, Huey Lewis, Robert Palmer, Bruce Hornsby, etc. Like basically all of the tapes, all the cassette tapes that my mom had in the car when I was growing up. Like this era is all that stuff. And this is maybe a little bit more of a controversial take that I have, is I think that, you know, these guys are all getting up there a little bit. They're not in their early 20s anymore. A lot of these guys are in their early to mid to late 30s, you know, starting out or becoming famous in the 60s and early 70s are now, they're older. And I think that there's that threshold that maybe we all cross over. When we start getting into our mid 30s, people are like, you know, I got to start making some money, because when I retire, I don't want to have to worry about any of this stuff. Or like, I want to make sure that my kids can, I can pay for their college and not have to worry about it. So there's that aspect. And then also this other aspect of the Reagan era and the like commercial big markets, no regulation, like the American dream in the United States, for instance, but it's also Thatcher in England. Like they basically are like, we set you free to achieve your financial dreams. Even though, of course, they're not, you know, mentioning the fact that they're basically just like cutting a lot of working class people off at the knees while they do that. But there's this concept of like, oh, hey, we can like get rich during that period, you know? So then a lot of these guys are just like, hey, you know what? Let's stop being these like hippy dippy idealist experimentalists. Let's just fucking hit the bricks hard, record a bunch of amazing 3-minute pop tunes and use all this new technology that like I don't even have to hire a whole band to be able to make, and just like crank out at least one or two albums that just go platinum. Of course, I'm not saying that it's not easy to do that. You have to have talent and ability. But a lot of these guys, like a lot of these guys that were like mainstays of the late 60s and 70s culture, just like kind of take off in the 80s. But anyway, like I said, that's kind of a hot take that I have. But I would say that, you know, I don't even find it that controversial, because even though I believe that and even though I think that, I still think it led to amazing results. Because in my opinion, you know, it's great to be idealistic and it's great to jam and it's great to like experiment. But like once you come across a great idea or a good hook or a good little melody line or a good little lyrical line, why don't you develop that? Why don't you turn that cool thing that happened from your jamming into something that's like tangible? While some people will say like, oh, the pop music formula, this 2 to 3 minute formula is, it's restrictive and it doesn't allow me to achieve all the things that are possible in music. And I mean, yeah, sure, that's great. That's fine. It's also a constraint. It's a limitation that you place upon the music. And when you place limitations on art, it can create this kind of alchemy effect. It can push it to be kind of greater than what the idea initially was, because you're forcing it, you're developing it, you're strengthening it, and you've given yourself this parameter to do it. I don't know. I feel like a lot of times it has some pretty great results. And even among these baby boomer guys who are like in their 30s, like Steve Winwood is one of the younger ones, because like we were mentioning before, he was like 16, 15, 16, 17 when he was with the Spencer Davis group and writing hits. And he was already a pop star at that early age. So he's only like, by the time 1980 rolls around, Steve Winwood is only 32 years old. So he's got some gas in the tank, and he will use that, as we shall see. After Ark of a Diver and Talking Back to the Night, Winwood has fully developed this new direction that he's moving in. He gets tapped by producer Russ Titelman, or Titelman, who's like this legendary producer, Randy Newman, Ry Cooder, James Taylor, George Harrison, Chaka Khan, Chrissy McVie, Eric Clapton, Meatloaf, Cyndi Lauper. You get the point. And so Russ approaches Steve and says, why don't we have you fly over here to the United States, get out of the countryside. Let's do the same thing that you're doing out there, but let's bring you into New York City and like let you soak up the energy and the vibes of the urban landscape. And so they did that. And the album Back in the High Life is the result of that. And I, you know, you got to hand it to Russ Titelman. He had a good idea and it definitely worked. That album is kind of less meditative and insular. It does have that kind of more urban sound to it. It's maybe a little bit more what quote unquote fun. Back in the High Life also features The Finer Things and Higher Love. Higher Love is again another one of those ones that like kind of everybody's heard. The Finer Things is also one that I bet you've heard, but it's like probably when you're shopping at like Marshall's, it comes over and you don't even notice it. It's like one of those songs. It's like I'm at Walgreens and I'm like buying some Band-Aids and then The Finer Things is coming on. And it's like you kind of, it just blends in with like the American strip mall culture. I don't know. And it's another Winwood and Jennings songwriting collaboration. And the next album after that kind of ties up this whole period in a neat little bow. In 1987, they release a greatest hits compilation called Chronicles, which is basically, it's not like all of his Steve Winwood's greatest hits, but it's like all the ones since Ark of a Diver. So all the kind of 80s production hits they put onto this compilation Chronicles. The song Valerie up until that point was not as popular. And I think they maybe remixed it for this compilation. And then that song becomes a really, really big, huge hit, which is obviously, you know, probably his most recognizable track. And then following Chronicles, you got 1988's Roll With It, which I think has some decent tracks. I think we're starting to see the arc of Steve Winwood's 80s output is starting to wane a bit. This sound that Winwood had developed in the 80s with Jennings is starting to find its starting to run out of momentum, in my opinion. Not that there's not some good tracks and stuff. It's just it's starting to get a little repetitive, a little formulaic. Refugees of the Heart in 1990 is just kind of completely runs out of steam. That is the last album also that Jennings does with Winwood. So after this, Winwood will be just on his own writing songs. But certainly this really cool thing that he was doing in the 80s has come to an end. And we can look back and reflect and appreciate it. So in the following years and subsequent decades, Steve Winwood received the sorts of accolades and praise that one would expect from such a legendary artist. He briefly reformed Traffic for a final tour. He went on tour with Eric Clapton and did a bunch of Blind Faith and Cream and Spencer Davis Group stuff. And, you know, he did a return to his roots kind of album in 2003 that features a lot of B3 organ. And just in general, he, you know, tours around, makes appearances, and just kind of enjoys being Steve Winwood. But to sum everything up here, over the course of his very long and uniquely commercially successful career, Winwood has solidified himself in the cultural and artistic zeitgeist of Western pop music. His laid-back, kind of down-to-earth personality shines through everything that he's done since his early career in the 1960s. His music has been sampled and remixed and covered by so many artists across all genres of music. But seemingly, the aspect of his music, which seems to rise above everything else, is the incredible power of his voice. Steve Winwood simply has one of the most recognizable and moving vocal styles in all of music. And whether or not you consider or label his style of singing to be a form of blue-eyed soul, or being influenced by African-American music, I think it's just obvious that it's unique, powerful, heart-wrenching, and uplifting just on its own merits. It's just, he's got it. Some people have it, some people don't. He just has one of those voices. It's just, you know, it's him immediately. And it's just very pleasing to the human ear, I think. At least my human ears. I, of course, encourage everyone to open up your Spotify, your Apple Music, your Amazon accounts, click through, listen to his catalog, listen to the greatest hits if you're not familiar. If you do, I promise there's going to be at least one of Winwood's tracks that's going to stir some fifis inside of you. Some emotions are going to get moved around in there. And hey, if not, you know, maybe you're already dead inside. And no, I'm just kidding. There's bound to be one of his songs that you're like, oh my gosh, that's just what a great track. I don't know which one it will be, but you know, maybe in the comments you put which one is your favorite Steve Winwood song. And as you're listening to this music and Steve Winwood's belting of Valerie echoes within the white walls of your dingy one bedroom apartment that you have confusingly agreed to pay $1,600 a month for, it is my hope that the power of his voice eases your economic and existential pain just a little bit and makes you say to yourself, I can't get it out of my head.